Heard of the University of Washington. We acknowledge the Coast Salish peoples of this land, the land which touches the shared waters of all tribes and bands within the Suquamish, Tulalip, and Lakota Nation. I'm Nicoletta Acosta, and today I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Michael Correll, who will speak at our seminar. Michael is currently a research scientist at Tableau Software, where he works in the area of information visualization. He's particularly interested in the ethical, accurate, and responsible communication of data, and also interested in graphical perception, text analytics, statistical graphics, and uncertainty visualization. Previously, Michael was a postdoc here at the University of Washington at the UW Interactive Data Lab in the Department of Computer Sciences. Michael received his PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison Department of Computer Sciences in 2015. Today, Michael will be sharing with us on how to cautiously construct charts. So it's all about visualization today. Thank you. And with that, I would like to welcome.
Great, thank you for the introduction. So can folks hear me okay, both here and then also the folks watching on the WebEx? Audio is good for that? Oh, audio is very quiet. Okay. How about now? Better? Worse? Okay. Let me, okay, I'm getting audio is good. Okay, so I will stand this distance from the mic, and if people can't hear me, that'll help you, it works. All right, so as mentioned, this is about cautiously constructing charts, and it's mostly sort of a talk driven by my own personal anxieties, which some of you may or may not share, but the sort of the general metaphor I'm gonna stick with and see if you people appreciate slightly ahistorical is sort of this notion of, if you look back, you know, 90 years ago, you know, Zeppelins were this really great thing. You know, you could get to South America in 3 days. There are all of these really exciting lines that were opening up between the US and North America and Europe, and this really big, shiny new piece of technology. And then the Hindenburg disaster happened, right? And that sort of was the end of lighter than air travel, sort of as a commercial conveyance. And I'm sort of thinking a little bit about what kind of our Hindenburg moment might look like for data analytics, for data science, for all of these related technologies, which have the same sort of utopian pitch to them. But I think we're sort of, to use a technical term, cruising for a bruising, right? And I mean, there's some obvious things that step out as kind of disastrous things when we look with data, right? So some of you may have seen something like this. So this was the UK was undercounting over 15,000 cases of COVID, which resulted in sort of 80,000 missed contact traces because they had the old version of Excel that limited you to like 10,000 rows per sheet, right? That's not great. That's, you know, something not ideal, right? So that's there are these big issues that it's really hard to see what's going on unless you do this deep dive into what's going wrong with your data. And there's also once we sort of have the data, it's unclear what we're supposed to do with it. Right. There's this essay I really like also about COVID data called "It's All Sports Now," right? Where we have all of this really detailed COVID information, like maybe some of it's accurate, maybe some of it's not, but you as a consumer, it's unclear what you're supposed to do with it, right? You just root for the home team. Like, man, I really hope that number goes down tomorrow, but there's not a lot that you as an individual can do about it, right? So it's just this numbing information that we don't know what to do with. And then lastly, right, there's sort of people who don't care about the data, right? So as an example of Sharpie Gate, where President Trump, you know, there was this hurricane prediction and literally drew on the map with a Sharpie where he thought the hurricane would go because he misspoke and said it was supposed to hit Alabama, and in fact it was not, right? So Elijah Meeks wrote this recap a couple years ago saying that Trump was our first data visualization president. And he didn't mean that as a compliment, right? What he meant is that we had now sort of lots of people, not just Trump, right? Not just sort of kind of depoliticized a little bit, lots of people where how the data looks is vastly more important than what the data are. Right? And then to open up even more cans of worms, right? I think in a lot of places, data analytics, we've sort of given things over to machine learning and algorithmic decision making and algorithmic data processing, which creates all of these sort of issues that people have written all of this great work about, sort of around bias and discrimination, right? But also the fact that a lot of these things just don't work. Okay, so these are really big, heady problems about data and how we interpret data. And yet, I'm a data visualization person. And so our papers are mostly about like bar charts, right? So there's all this stuff about data, and the impression we get is that everything's fine, right? Glad those aren't our problems. And I suggest maybe that they are, some of them are. So in particular, I'm going to tell you a story about a particular visualization. And this is a visualization that if you sort of showed it to the visualization community by sort of the usual standards, which are mostly design-based, right? Is it a good design of the visualization? It seems to check out. So this is energy usage over time. This is actually based on a data set that ships with Tableau. So my 15 seconds of shilling is if you want to play around with this data set, you can get an educational license as a student and mess around with it. But it's looking at energy usage over time. And I happen to know for a fact that, you know, I loaded the data incorrectly, whatever that means, like the chart rendered correctly. I think it's, you know, a pretty clear, maybe slightly too minimalist design of the information. And there's rules for design that I happen to know, and it mostly follows them. So this is maybe a good chart. But I'm going to tell you a story about it. So the first one is, it seems to be telling a story that energy usage was going up. And then in 2012, we just banded together as a global community and said, we're going to stop global warming and everything's going to be fine. That's not actually what happened, right? So the reason it has this little pattern here is that this is not energy usage, it's sum of energy usage. And we're missing a ton of data for 2012. So if you look at the number of countries that we're missing almost all of them. Okay, so maybe the sum isn't a great metric. We should use like a central tendency, like a mean or a median. So if I switch to a mean, or in this case, an average energy usage, now I get the opposite pattern, right? So energy usage is going steadily up, and then in 2012, it went way up. Okay, so that's kind of concerning too, but that's also not true, right? And the reason it's not true is because the countries that are missing are not random, right? For 2012, the only data in this data set is from the OECD countries, which are mostly, you know, Western Europe and North America, Australia, East Asia, and things like that. So these are, you know, highly developed countries and so have higher energy usage than other ones. Okay, so you have this chart. It seems to be following the rules and seems to be doing a good thing. But if you dig deeper at it and dig deeper at a non-obvious way, right? Like I had to kind of go into this data, see what's going on. I had to know a little bit about the world. What I take away from this chart, totally false, right? And it's unclear how I fix it to make it less false. So those are sort of the anxieties and suspicions that are going to be driving the rest of this talk, right? Is that we have some rules for visualization that we think are these hard and fast design rules. But they kind of go away when you look at them, or they're certainly not complete, right? There's this whole ecosystem of ways that visualizations can fail, even if they follow the design rules, even if they clearly present the data. And then I'm going to maybe gesture towards some ways that we could help people detect these two issues, right? Like if the rules won't save us, maybe there's some other interventions we can make. All right, so first, a little bit about visualization rules. Often when people think about visualization, the person they think of is Edward Tufte. Edward Tufte proposed a rule which he sort of thinks is as atomic or axiomatic for designing a good visualization, and he calls it the lie factor, which he actually mathematically defines here, right? As if there is a size of an effect in your graphic divided by the size of the effect in the data, and you want that to be pretty close to one. Right? If it's greater than one, then you're sort of exaggerating. And if it's less than one, you're underestimating the size of the effect. Right? He literally meant this sort of as a calculation, right? So an example that he uses in his book here is here's an infographic of fuel prices. And they tried to do like this weird perspective thing to make it look like you're going down a road. But what that means is that the first data point, which is, you know, 1978, it's 18 miles per gallon. And then in 85, it's 27 miles per gallon, right? Which is not that big of an increase, right? Like, you know, it's doubling essentially. But the line is way, way longer, right? Like almost like 10 times longer. And so what you get is this lie factor of 14.8. So because it's using perspective, the links of the lines aren't emblematic of the effects in the data, so that's bad. Maybe it's a little more abstract, but sort of where this often gets applied is what's called y-axis truncation. So if you Google image search like bad visualization, misleading visualization, again, there's a blog post that calls this a visualization that fails at life. This is from Fox News, and everyone says this is really misleading because it's showing this increase in tax rate from 35 to 39.6%, but the y-axis starts at 34%. And so if you plug in your numbers into Tufte's equation, right, you know, the bar on the right is like 4 or 5 times larger than the bar on the left, but it's only like a 13% increase in taxes, so that's a lie factor of almost 30. And so the lesson you get from this is never, ever, ever start the y-axis of your bar chart from anything other than zero, or you'll mislead people. The lie factor will just totally swamp whatever signal you're putting. And yeah, here's a graph. It was published from the National Review. They called it the only climate change chart you'll ever need. It is global temperature in Fahrenheit. This is actually, this data is correct, like as far as I know, right? It's a little weird, but I'd argue that this is a misleading visualization, even though it does start at zero. Well, it actually starts at negative 10 for some reason, but you know, y-axis and x-axis cross at zero. And I think it's misleading because if the global average temperature is 0 degrees, then everybody is dead. And if the global average temperature is like 110 degrees, then everybody is dead, right? So to me, what this means is that there's this small difference in temperature that we're supposed to care about, right? Like 1 or 2 degrees can be catastrophic, but we can't see it on this chart. So in trying to make the effect like real, right, to reduce the lie factor, make it one, we actually lose the message of this chart, right? Or I can't see what I need to see in this chart, right? So here I actually want to truncate me. All right, so now this rule that we've looked at doesn't seem to hold in this case. So we were curious about that, right? Like what have people said about it? A lot, it turns out, for over a century, there's over a century of literature on truncating the y-axis. And some, of course, very recent stuff. Even Wikipedia has an opinion about it, which is kind of weird. They normally don't have opinions about these kinds of things. But we, you know, all this work, we sort of condense into 3 categories. So the first, and I've maybe put Tufte in this camp, although he actually got a little bit more nuanced about this later on, is what I call the anathemas, which is you never ever truncate the graph because you're trying to show an effect size and you're exaggerating the effect size if you truncate it, so never do it. Then you have these people I call the line graph exceptionalists, which are like, oh, well, yeah, of course, for bar charts, never do that. But if it's a line chart, that's cool because you actually want like to see the trend, and the trend is not the value, and so you can do whatever you want with the axes there. And then last is a group of people called the signalers, which is, okay, yeah, it's weird to truncate the y-axis, but sometimes you have to, like that's the range of the data. So if you do, then you should signal to your viewer somehow. So the one example is using this like torn paper metaphor. One thing that all of these positions had in common, as far as we could tell, is no one had actually tested any of these things or asked anyone. They've just sort of said stuff, which is a pretty good gig if you can get it in academia. But we for some reason decided to test things. And so what we did is literally presented sort of stimuli like this, kind of like the Fox News chart, where, you know, it's either it's a bar, it's a line, we truncate it or we don't truncate it. And then we tried a few different ways of signaling. Right, so one is sort of this broken axis technique, which is what Wikipedia recommends, right? You should include something on the y-axis that said, hey, there's a gap here. Or this second one where you sort of have this little gradient thing down, which is like, hey, these bars continue. Right, so we just showed these to a bunch of folks, asked them to sort of rate, like sort of how big are these trends, right? Like, you know, do you care about this trend? Like, what's the numerical value of these trends like that? But the sort of most important measure was sort of like how serious do you think this trend is going to be? Just a rating scale measure. And so the results of that study, I will not make you do a drum roll, I guess. But first one is that everything is bad. And so what I mean is that, so here, these little panels on left to right are showing where we started the y-axis, exact same data in all cases. But what happened is the more we truncate the y-axis, the more severe the trend was perceived as being. So where you start that y-axis seems to matter. And then the other thing is that nothing seemed to help or matter. Right. So here we tried bars and lines, pretty much the same response. We tried these different signaling types, also pretty much same response. So you could take away with this and saying, okay, maybe Tufte was onto something here. Maybe people do seem to exaggerate the effects of trends depending on where you start the y-axis. But I'd like maybe to introduce just a little bit of nuance and say that the real takeaway here is that it is up to you as the designer to determine what is an important effect size for the data that you're showing. Right, so for instance, that like big scary graph I showed you, if you actually look at tax rate over time, like it's a jump, right? But it's historically kind of peanuts, right? But if you've only seen that flat period for a long time, maybe it's more. So there's an example of a rule. If you look at the rule empirically, even with a really sort of simple empirical experiment, you can see it's kind of troubling, right? It's not necessarily black and white. But maybe there's things we can do to alert people, like if we think they need to use their own guidance to determine whether the rule is going on, you know, is the correct one or not, we can do a little bit of guidance there. And so what we did there is looking at paradigms of sort of error reporting, or in programming, it's called linting, stylistic linting, to try to determine what's going on in the visualization, give people some evidence that maybe what they're showing is kind of misleading. So some terminology we use to kind of make this work is this notion of a visualization mirage, right? So this is a chart, just like the one I showed you earlier, where it purports to show something, like maybe, you know, temperature is not changing, or in this case, maybe energy usage went way down. But when you dig into it, it goes away. That's sort of the idea. And there's lots of sort of ways that mirages can happen. And there's also sort of lots of ways that sort of the same graph can hide information. Okay, so here I have a bar chart of sales. There's lots of ways I could have generated this bar chart, right? It could just literally be two values. It could be an aggregate. It could be an aggregate with an outlier, right? Maybe that difference between X and Y is just being driven by one extreme point. It could be very different sample sizes, right? Maybe I have repeated data, maybe I have way fewer information for X than Y. And so I don't actually know how seriously to take that difference, right? And even the error bars might necessarily help. So these kinds of things where you see the chart, once you dig into it, you might come away with totally different impressions, can happen everywhere, right? In the sort of process. So imagine, you know, this is a very abstract visualization design process, but imagine the world exists out there. I've decided what to collect or curate from the world. That becomes my data set. I get that data into the right shape for me to do analysis on it, and I prepare it. Right. Then I finally visualize it, and then someone else in the world has to go out and read my visualization. So pretty much any of these steps are where these kinds of mirages can be introduced. And we have maybe some techniques for dealing with them sort of on the ends of the pipeline, right? So we have this notion of sort of research ethics or like data engineering, right? These skill sets around making sure that you have the right data. And then at the end, and I think this is kind of fuzzier, right? This notion of like statistical education, graphical literacy, like teaching yourself not to be fooled by the visualizations that you see. But there's stuff in the middle where we start getting into more sort of software solutions. Right? So if I want to know that the data I've created is actually useful, maybe I need something like anomaly detection, right, to find those outliers. Maybe I need like a data flow, so I know exactly what I did to my data before I started visualizing it. There's some tools that do that, for instance, a profiler, which later sort of rolled up into Trifecta, another sort of data wrangling tool. Like we'll have this anomaly browser in your data. But I think it's this step here, this visualization step, and I could be being myopic here, but I think that's where we can maybe intervene, because I'm not sure what the state of the ground is. Right? We have maybe these rules that tell you how to avoid fooling people, but I don't know what else we have. So we tried a couple things to try to intervene in this particular stage of the data analytics pipeline. And the first thing we did is this notion of linting, right? So we looked at ways of just alerting people on the chart itself in the same way you might get like a red squiggly line if you're misspelling something in spell check, with spell check for visualization. And so we tried different interventions just for like dirt simple chart rules that seem like at least we should tell you that that's what's happening. Right? So one is that if you're using size to encode data, maybe you shouldn't have negative values. Because what does negative size mean? Like that's something we can detect and show you. Right? If you're using a dual axis chart, first off, you maybe shouldn't be. But second off, like if they're rapidly, totally different rates of change between the two, that might be kind of misleading too. If you've got colors that are too close to each other to be discriminated reliably, that's something we can detect and show you as well. If you got rid of your legend, and I really need a legend to make sense of what's going on in the chart, also something I can show you. Right? And then truncated wire axis, maybe it's a problem, maybe it's not, but I can at least tell you what's going on. And also sometimes like the opposite problem, if I make my y-axis too short and my, you know, some of my data doesn't fit in it. So we tried these sort of detection techniques, and what we did is either I visually alert you to something that's going on in the chart, or I textually alert you, like I just write underneath the chart, you know, hey buddy, check your y-axis, or both. Right? And so we showed these to people and just asked them to identify, hey, you know, is there something weird with this chart? Can you identify it? And what we found is kind of good news, maybe not. What we did is this is prior, is before we gave them any training or any linting, and like, couldn't they just detect these flaws on their own? Now, some of these I think are pretty obvious flaws, right? And then we gave them these linting techniques and see how good they were at identifying things after the fact. And what we found is, okay, yes, some interventions seem to help here. Like if I give you something, it's better than nothing. But I want you to look at sort of the x-axis here. Like we're topping out at like, you know, 25, 30, 40% accuracy for these best additions. Even though these are, I think, you know, pretty no-brainer errors, right? Like if you submitted this to an assignment, hopefully your professor would say, hey, there's something going on here. But it shows that maybe we can do something. But these are all like design stuff. I don't think they really get at some of these deeper sort of analytical issues that are going on with the chart. And so for that, we'll need sort of a different metaphor. And so something else we tried is what we call sort of fuzz or permutation testing. Or in particular, a subset that seemed most promising is this idea of metamorphic testing. So metamorphic testing is something that actually came out of the shader realm. But the general idea, if you like, is if I do something that totally doesn't matter and something weird happens, that means that my design is probably screwed. Similarly, if I do something that should be really, really important and nothing changes, that also suggests something may be going on. So as an example from graphic shaders, they write a shader program and then you just include this like for loop that doesn't do anything. Because of how poorly some shader compilers are optimized, it actually results in a different image for this particular shader. Right? So this code that literally shouldn't do anything whatsoever ended up having an effect, which suggests that there's a problem in the compiler. Here the compiler is like our brains, I guess, which is a little bit trickier, but the same general idea. All right, so we're gonna show you how we can maybe apply these to things like visualization. So here I have a scatter plot. Taken from sort of the same data set I was showing you earlier, of life expectancy and health expenditure as part of GDP. So I'm going to do something that should matter. I have just removed 10% of the values of the scatter plot on the right. If I take away 10% of your data, hopefully something should happen. But here I think it's really, really tough. I could like make you do like spot the difference thing. There really are some things different, but it's you just can't see it. I can take away 70% of the data and now it becomes noticeable, but that's a lot of data, right? Like something strange is going on. Similarly, so that's something that should matter and didn't seem to. Similarly, something that shouldn't matter is if I just change the draw order of the groups. So here it's the exact same data. I just, on the left, I decided to draw the orange group last on the right, I decided to draw it first. And you get a totally different picture of the chart there, right? So what we've learned from this is that this scatter plot is horribly overdrawn. Like there's so many points that they're all just drawn on top of each other, and it's really, really hard to see what's going on in the scatter plot. That's something that if I just showed you this and maybe didn't tell you what was going on, it would be hard to pick up. But we can just do these really, really simple, like not computationally expensive, kind of shuffling and permuting tests as you know, as kind of like a, if you will, like sort of black hat way of looking at vulnerabilities. So we implemented several of these kinds of things, just like, you know, changing the order we draw points. That shouldn't matter. But there are other big things, like if we totally break the causal link between categories, maybe that should matter. And then these other things, which are a little bit iffier, right? Which is, you know, we have differing sample sizes. If we adjust the sample sizes of groups to make them the same, what happens? So we implemented this in a system, and it lets you pick out some of these things, like overplotting, like sort of high variability and high noise pretty reliably, right? And that you can see sort of how a visualization has changed or not changed as a result. But I see maybe a little bit of skepticism, which probably should be, which is that, okay, that's some operations, but there's this, I just spent a few slides at least saying that there's this whole host of visualization mirages that can happen anywhere in the data pipeline, all the way from data engineering down to like graphical literacy or something. What do we do about that? And then there's this signal to noise ratio, right? Like how much stuff can I do before it should matter or shouldn't matter? And then this last one, which I think is more sort of a UX, UI, or even sort of educational problem of how do we actually communicate? Like I can say, hey, there's too many points on the scatter plot, but what do I say? You know, 70% of the time we ran this permutation test, it produced a visually distinct image. Like, what is that? Right. So I think there's some unsolved problems here. And the bigger unsolved problem is something, and I've been desperately trying to find the actual source of this. And if I can't find it, I'll just name it after myself. But right now it's called, I'm gonna call it Lippi's Law of Human Computer Collaboration, which is that we have this really tough problem. We wanna help people and intervene and like suggest that things might be going wrong. And so now sort of what we did is invented Lippi, but with some extra steps. And I think that that's kind of generally kind of an interesting sort of notion to think about is what does it actually mean to intervene in a useful way? Because I have to figure out the user intent and maybe have to figure out the reader intent. And now I don't necessarily know what to do about it. Right. So as sort of a wrap up of this portion of the talk, right, we have these good rules and maybe some bad rules. Visualizations, they don't necessarily seem to cut. They don't necessarily seem to produce things. But I think there's this bigger ecosystem of how visualizations can work. So the challenge, sort of as designers of visualizations or maybe as people thinking in this space, is what's the right thing to do in terms of surfacing the data? We can test for some of them, we can surface some of them. Others, I don't think we can. I think we actually need to like mess with people's brains, make them think better, stronger, deeper, faster. And then this last notion, which I think is kind of interesting, is how do we build sort of a skeptical? So that is a lot of me dumping my anxieties on you, but the general idea is that I want to avoid visualization Hindenburg. Things just generally going wrong. And with that, I think I will actually transition over to questions. I think there are a few you talk. Of those first, but otherwise, take them from mine. So, at least see one is can you truncate values in the x axis, like in a scatter plot? Yeah, absolutely. You can also do something really weird with scatter plots where you can increase the y axes, like make them go super far beyond the data, and that compresses all the points together. And if you do that in the right way, you can make total random noise looks like it's perfectly correlated. So yeah, there's plenty of truncation tricks you can play with that. Other ones, yeah. Yeah, I will try to restate it for the Zoom, and you can correct me if I. But I think it's generally sort of how do you communicate? First off, how do you communicate like some of these visualization issues to people who maybe don't have a visualization background or a design background? And then also, especially since often when you're working with data analytics or data science or data visualization, you're working with people that have their own expertise. So how do you jump in and not be a jerk? I guess maybe is a summary of that question. So is that sort of sufficient to capture that thing? So I think it's tough, right? So one of the things that I think people often underestimate is that data visualization is not like, it is a learned and acquired ability. It's a thing that you're exposed to, right? Like you build up your own literacy with books in different ways, in the same way you build up your own literacy with charts in different ways. Right? It is a form of expertise. One of the things that I find One of the potential Hindenburg moments in data science is this idea of sort of parachute research or drop-in research, where we assume that our skills are transportable. Like, you guys in epidemiology, you have data. I know about data, so I can come in and immediately help you with your problems. That's a really dangerous impulse, right? Like, there is expertise that they develop. They don't necessarily, like, you coming in and trying to help them with all the problems without fully understanding them is pretty dangerous. But I think in terms of techniques for doing it successfully are treat it like a collaboration, right? You're not coming down from on high to tell them how to design things. You're saying, you know, here's what I have learned, here's what I have observed, and also giving them sort of the, if you like, the technology or patterns to usefully interpret what you're saying, right? So we have certain abstractions that we build in visualization, that we build in data science, so just communicating with those abstractions, but also communicating with human beings. Let's see, that's a really long-winded answer to your question. Let me think of an actual shorter one that might be helpful. I think generally come from a place of mutual power and mutual respect. Like there's a law of power, right, which is that if someone can tell you to go away and you have to listen to them, that tends to be a good sign that there's at least like some mutual control over the relationship. But it's working with people. Working with people is a known hard problem. So, yeah. Yeah, so the question was, like, we have APA and other sort of like reporting standards for things like statistics. Maybe we should also have those for data visualization. I'm of two minds about that. So one is when you see people, when for instance, news organizations they explicitly have these plotting standards. Right, like they have even sort of in-house style guides, right? Like, so this chart is by John Byrne Murdoch for the Financial Times. I can tell you that even if I had taken away the byline, just because I know, that's the Financial Times colors, that's John Byrne Murdoch's plot, right? So that kind of branding stuff really works, and actually he's a great source for looking at how you exactly design these things for public communication. Like, he takes a lot of sort of iterations and talks with people and tries to get them right. So I don't want to discount sort of that way of doing it. But I think that visualization in many cases to me is closer to written language than it is to statistical reporting. And I have to interrogate that to think of how deeply I hold that belief. But I think for different audiences and for different styles, there are different tasks, right? There are different visual designs that seem to be up. And I think you should target, just like you target your writing towards what will be effective for your audience, you should target your visualization for what will be effective. right? And sometimes that does mean standardization. So an example that I like is that in climatology, often what you'll see is what's called a rainbow color map, right? Which is, you know, red is the highest value and violet is the lowest value, or vice versa. And everyone in visualization like really turns up their nose on these things, because like they have lots of problems. Like for one, if you're colorblind, you're kind of SOL. For another, like we don't really perceive color uniformly. Like we have these little bands that we perceive. So if you actually, even if you look like a smooth gradient, it looks like a bullseye, if you show it as a rainbow plot. But climatologists use them all the time, and people have tried fixing them to make them sort of more perceptually uniform, and often the performance goes down, because that's what they're used to. Like that's the like visualization milieu they're in. So in that case, it's a standard. It's maybe not even the best standard, but it works for them. So who are we to say to go in and change it? Even though we have like all of these, you'll be 2 seconds faster if you're on Mechanical Turk if you use this color. Right, but as an opposite case, there are cardiologists that were using rainbow color map, not necessarily as involved in their field. This is work by Michelle Borkin and other folks. I think she's now at Northeastern. And they changed the color ramp. The doctors hated it because they weren't used to it. But then they're like, misdiagnoses went down. All right, okay, you've convinced me. Right, so standards sometimes help, sometimes don't. Sometimes it's an empirical question. But it's also long and unsatisfying, but oh well. Yeah. So the question is for visualization linting, have we implemented it in Tableau in any way? Sort of, in some piecemeal areas. So certainly the systems I've described are not physically in Tableau. Some equivalent systems we have is we do have these things called null warts, which like tell you that there's null data. And it shows up as a little wart in the bottom right. And we also implicitly implement some of these things. So for instance, our defaults are kind of based around not letting you make some of the mistakes that I showed, at least in the earlier design work. Like by default, our bar charts start at zero. In Excel, they do not start at zero. So you know, philosophical differences between the two. And then also we have this feature called explain data, which is sort of a newer feature that attempts to get at some of these tests around like outliership or unequal sample size to say like, hey, like this dot in your scatter plot is really far away. Why is that? Tries to come up with some explanations that might suggest this thing. But the actual permutation testing, I think there's statistical questions of like what tests are useful to run. There's engineering questions of how do you make those tests fast? And I think there's UI, UX questions of how do you surface them in a meaningful and interpretable way? So I haven't solved those yet. So maybe later. Okay, so the question was for the permutation system that we developed, were those tests automated or not? And then how do we surface them? So that what I can give you a short answer that's unsatisfying, which is that they were totally automated for the purpose of this paper, because we literally just threw the kitchen sink at your graph. Right, so if you actually, for instance, load this system, you'll see, right, we have all of these linting rules. Think of it sort of like linting rules in a program compiler. You maybe have like hundreds of rules that's checking for all of them, and it'll try to surface violations for you. So that's what we did in the system that we built. And that is exactly 100%, I think, the wrong solution for if you were trying to build the system like practically. Like for research, proof of concept code, maybe it's the thing to do, but right, dealing with like, can you imagine like building a bar chart and then you have to wait for it to run a bunch of tests, and then you get like several dozen of them, maybe they passed, maybe they failed, you have to interpret it. Like I don't think that's a great user experience. And also some of these tests kind of don't necessarily make sense in certain contexts, right? So the question of scoping them down. So I think refining those rules and refining those tests, and then yeah, refining the UX are things. Oh, it looks like I'm not actually in the Q&A box, in the chat box. So I will bring that up. Yeah. Yeah, so I can pull them up there. All right. Intuitions behind which mirages are easy versus hard, and those that can be automated versus need additional intervention. Are there classes of mirages? So for that one, the answer is yes. Let me quickly switch. I'm going to stop share and move to a different slide that has more on that. This will do. Right, am I still sharing on Zoom? Probably not. Let's see. There we go. Okay. So there's different classes of mirages. We came up with a really ad hoc list of several hundred of your favorite. We've color coded them based on where I think they occur in this process. Some of these I think are stuff that we can fix pretty easily. Right, so like one, like if there's differing sample sizes, right? We can detect that, right? Like that's just a call to a database. And then there are these like graphical visualization ones. Some of them I think are easy or hard, right? Like finding out whether you've truncated the y-axis, really, really easy. Finding if there's like a few outliers, or if there's a lot of overplotting, maybe it requires like a little bit of like screen space finagling, but it's something you could do. And then there's these ones that occur on the edges, right, about how you read the visualization, how you pick the data set to visualize what you're trying to communicate. That just like it is a category error to think of them as visualization lints to deal with, right? Like, so for instance, there's this artist, Mimi Onoha. She has this piece she calls the Library of Forgotten Datasets, or sorry, of Missing Datasets. It's just a file cabinet of data sets that would be really, really useful societally to have that we don't have, right? Or we don't have publicly. Like, how much does Spotify pay its artists? We don't know that. Right? Like, we also don't know, like, for instance, like infant mortality rates among different races in the United States. That's information that we don't really have super ready access to. Really crucially important data sets. We don't have them. So if you try to visualize things about those societal patterns, you just won't be able to, right? I don't think a little like linting device on my computer is going to tell you, hey, there's like systematic injustices in what data you collected. Like maybe you can identify some like per population biases, but you know, these are societal questions, right? Or like, how do you build critical thinking skills, right? I don't think there's necessarily going to be a little like red button on your machine that says, hey, you don't have enough critical thinking skills for this chart, right? Like, I don't think that's how you design the thing. So those categories, especially those categories on the end, like those are people problems. Those aren't design problems, even though design problems are also people problems, right? So that's how I would frame that. Right, and then second one is, do you have any suggestions for thinking about when projection is a lie? That is, when we need to reduce the dimensionality of the visualization, how can we be sure it's not misleading? I'm actually doing work on precisely that question. So I guess to restate it for this audience, right, if you have really high dimensional data, it's really hard to think in high dimensions. So what you do is you project it down using like ECA or MDS or some other strategy into a scatter plot. I suspect I'm being a curmudgeon about this, but I never find those plots useful. Even the ones that people claim to be useful, like I think I can recognize like the handwriting data set like on site now. They either tell me things that I probably could have learned in a different like easier to understand format, like, you know, like hierarchical clustering or something, right? Like, hey, these stuff is close together, this stuff is not close together. That's kind of all I get from them. And it's also really easy to misinterpret. So for instance, one of the first projects I worked on in graduate school was designing a system for Shakespeare scholars, digital humanists that were looking at sort of language usage in Shakespeare's plays. And I designed this sort of like PCA system that lets them like look to see how the plays are related and things like that. And what they would do is come up with these like really kind of sophisticated stories about what each of the axes meant. Like there was one that said like, you know, this particular principal component puts all of the plays, all of Shakespeare's plays that have fairies in them in one cluster. So I'm gonna call it the fairy detector. Like, I don't know how to evaluate that claim. It's literally made perhaps true for that data set, but I don't think that necessarily picks out a structure that's important. So to me, the fact that these projections require us to make a big leap in determining what these axes are and what they mean, to me, I think narrows their use. And in fact, I usually suggest not using them, but I also will admit that everyone else seems to like them, so I suspect I'm just like raining on their parade. All right, any other questions, either from live or in the... Otherwise, I will give folks 10 minutes back.
Well, no.
Oh, okay, great.
One more question.
Yes. So I have a website. I also have a Medium blog that I post stuff on. And then our research group, research.tableau, has pretty much the papers we're working on. And they also have a Medium post called the Tableau Engineering blog about stuff we're doing. Oh, and the question was, where can you find more of the crap I'm doing? Okay. What are ways that we can be knowledgeable advocates for reliable, generally valid visualizations in our respective disciplines? I think that's this. I would say probably the ways for being advocates there are, right, employ productive skepticism, right? Think, always think critically, but also know that like critical thinking is not like the end all be all. Right, just it's very easy to think critically about stuff, but it's harder to sort of like, be productive. I sometimes fall too far over that line, as maybe this talk indicated. But I think it's more sort of thinking about what is a, yeah, thinking it, treating it like a communication problem, right? You're trying to persuade people, either implicitly or not, that the information you're showing them is useful and reliable and accurate. So think about the ways that you persuade people of those things when you don't have data, right? Or when we're persuading using language or persuading using art or the other forms of rhetoric that we have. Visualization's not so radically different from all of those things, right? It's about building a case and supporting that case. It just sticks with bars and lines instead of sentences. Okay. Yep, just down the street.